Hachette Audio presents Westwind, written by Ian Rankin, read by Julian Rhind-Tutt.
Introduction by the author. Westwind was originally published on Thursday, March the 1st, 1990. My diary entry for that day announces the fact thus. Yes, Westwind was published to one review in The Guardian and very small. Jesus, a flop from the word go. As you can see, I was not in what is these days referred to as a good place in the early months of 1990, as my diary of the time regularly records. Here's Wednesday, February 28th. I was wondering today, when will Westwind be published? I knew it was scheduled for March and books are always published on a Thursday, but it can't be tomorrow, surely. Barry and Jenkins, my publisher at the time, would have been in touch re possible sources of publicity. Surely my author's copies should have arrived. But on returning home, a gift bottle of whiskey greeted me. Must be tomorrow then, with so little ceremony. It's easy to be sanguine as I look back at my younger self, but I was demonstrably starting to lose belief in my abilities, doubting my future as a publishable writer. I was also slogging my guts out, working a day job in London and trying to find space to write in what free time remained to me. My first rebus novel, Knots and Crosses, had been published without fanfare in 1987. On May the 12th that year, I recorded in my trusty diary that I should be doing the satellite novel. Westwind, in other words. I'm doing nothing. Well, not exactly nothing, because at the same time I was also polishing the spy thriller, which would appear the following year as Watchmen. I was living in Tottenham and working as an assistant at the National Folktale Centre, based at what was then Middlesex Polytechnic. Unusually for London, this meant I could walk to work. It also gave me access to a computer. While at home, I still hammered away on a noisy electric typewriter. Not that the computer with its large floppy disks was much use to me. I didn't know anyone else, my publisher included, who used one. My first Amstrad word processor was still a ways off, while the fax machine in my workplace remained as mysterious to me as the Sphinx. I'm not sure what gave me the idea that a techno thriller would be my next project. Knots and Crosses had been a fairly traditional whodunit. Watchmen was a spy novel influenced by Graham Greene's The Human Factor. Westwind, on the other hand, would start with a space shuttle plummeting to Earth and a malfunctioning satellite. It seems to me now that I was feeling my way towards what kind of writer I wanted to be. High on the list was successful enough to give up the day job. I tried the crime novel and the spy novel, and now I was going to attempt to write the sort of high-tech thriller that sold by the pallet load in airports and railway stations. So it was that I visited my local library on Tottenham High Road and asked the librarian for anything they could give me to do with space shuttles and how satellites worked. Many of the resulting books proved too technical for me. My degree was in English literature rather than mathematics and physics, but a few proved useful. I'll admit now that one of them was a children's book. Then there was the trusty Rand McNally Road Atlas of the USA, since part of the book was going to be set there. International sales ahoy! And I'd yet to visit that country, outside of novels, movies and TV shows. As you can see, I was young, hungry, naive and driven. Turning to my diaries again to help me with this introduction, I was surprised at the long gestation of Westwind. The first mention I can find is May 1987, and by June I was happily at work on it. At this time it was called Coffin Burial, and my one issue was that my typewriter needed repairing. In July 87 I was chipping away at it while also editing Watchmen. By August, I was having doubts, but in September, I was finding some of the writing very exciting and heart-pounding. By December, the first draft of the book was finished, and the title had been changed to Westwind. I'm not sure where Coffin Burial came from. I did think it was a poem, but I can't find it on the internet. My memory was it might have been John Masefield, but again, I can't find it in a list of his works, though I did come across a poem of his called The West Wind. Coincidence? My agent read the book over the festive period and got back to me in January 1988. He was not enthusiastic and wanted major revisions before submitting it to a publisher. Okay, so by March I'd tweaked a book and then everything seemed to go quiet. There was TV interest in Noughts and Crosses, and I was also working on a script for a potential film of my first novel, The Flood. I was also getting ready for publication of Watchmen and applying for jobs with a bit more pay than I was getting at Middlesex Poly. By May, I was at work on a new Rebus novel, which would eventually see the light of day as Hide and Seek. And by the summer, I'd secured work as a journalist on a monthly magazine called Hi-Fi Review. Watchmen was out and receiving some good reviews, if decidedly sluggish sales, and Westwind was languishing. By September, my agent was apologising that he still had no takers for the revised book. I was almost too busy to notice. My new job came with a 90-minute each-way commute, during which I was devouring novels which I'd started reviewing for the newspaper Scotland on Sunday. I'd also been approached to pitch script ideas to ITV's The Bill, and I was working away between times on the Rebus book. Then, praise be, my agent phoned with news. My old editor from Bodley Head, who'd taken both Noughts and Crosses and Watchmen, had switched publishers and was now at Barry and Jenkins. He wanted to revitalise their meagre fiction list. In short, he wanted Westwind. By January 1989, I was discussing further edits to the book, and by March, I'd signed a contract. 1989 saw me continuing to write Hide and Seek, at this point titled Deadbeat, while revising Westwind, and still working as a Hi-Fi reviewer. Westwind was eventually finished by July. I had a new editor by then, however, and she disliked some of the book's tone, finding it too humorous for a thriller. She wanted a tougher book, and I did my best to comply, meaning a further edit. Which brings us to March the 1st, 1990, and publication. Not that anyone noticed. There was one hardcover printing, one paperback, and one in large format for readers with limited sight. It didn't sell to the USA, and no foreign language publisher wanted it. What's more, the book had taken so long to get into print and been through so many permutations and revisions that I could muster very little enthusiasm for it myself. Every time my agent or editor had asked me to rework it, I'd acquiesced, until it felt like it wasn't really my book at all, certainly not the one I'd set out to write. So I decided that it would rest in a dark corner of my consciousness, never to see the light of day again. Until Twitter changed my mind. There had been the odd occasion where a fan at a signing would tell me they'd read it and liked it. Those fans had either got lucky in charity shops or else had shelled out a lot of money to a book dealer. Yes, the book had its fans, but I wasn't among them, until someone on Twitter persuaded me to give the book another look. "It's better than you think it is, Ian." It had been so long since I'd read it that it felt like reading another writer's work. This proved to be a good thing. I could be objective as I raced through the pages. Yes, it had a few faults, and some of the sentence construction was overwrought. It also felt a little bit dated, but on the other hand, it also seemed prescient. I had set it in an alternative 1990, where American troops are being pulled out of Europe, international tensions are high, the US is retrenching, and the military is worried about the future direction Europe will take. Satellites circle Earth, being used potentially to spy on everyone and everything. No one knows who to trust or what's about to happen. Yes, I saw plenty of parallels with the current geopolitical situation, but I also enjoyed reading it. The characters came to life, the plot was pacey, the villains were scary, and the heroes believable. And oh, the nostalgia. Central locking for cars was obviously a fairly new thing. Not remote central locking, mind. Since I mentioned it much more than once. Then there were the filofaxes, the floppy disks and cassette tapes, people smoked on aeroplanes, Tower Records had arrived at Piccadilly Circus, and Germany was still divided into East and West. I'd forgotten that the listening base where Martin Hepton works was sited at Binbrook in Lincolnshire, a location I'd chosen because my sister Maureen, married to an RAF technician, had lived there for several years, and I'd stayed with her as a teenager over the course of one or two long, hot school holiday summers, back in the days when I was convinced I was going to be either a rock star or a poet. This is partly why I have the notion that Coffin Burial must have been a poem, but during the course of writing the book, I started disliking that title. My British spy satellite was called Zephyr, and a Zephyr is a light...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.